Okay guys, so today I thought we would talk a little bit about realistic standards for gaining muscle and strength. And I thought we'd also talk a little bit about the elite level of competitive sports slash performing arts like bodybuilding and powerlifting. I'm one of the people who consider bodybuilding, modeling, that sort of idea, performing art, considering the fact that it's not really a sport. Everybody who goes on stage looks amazing. It's just who, according to the judges, looks better. And that's all there is to it as far as that's concerned, as far as I'm concerned with it. But I do consider sports, I do consider powerlifting and strongman and Olympic weightlifting sports because they are quantifiable in nature. So let's talk about, first of all, elite level competitors in the fitness world. Now, just like I said, all of those different endeavors involve gaining size and strength. And I was having a conversation with a very good friend of mine a few days ago about, he didn't really realize that some elite level strongmen and bodybuilders were potentially using gear. And if you look at their statistics, if you have a fat-free mass index that's over 25, well over 25, you have either elite genetics, as in you are a god on earth, you are a top 1% of the entire population of 7 billion, or you are on anabolic steroids. Now, if you have those amazing genetics, and you are an elite level competitor, and you are trying to become the best in the world, if you can do anabolic steroids for a little while and get a superior edge, especially in divisions of competition that don't test for them, why wouldn't you do them? Because genetics alone is often not enough when it comes to your strength and size in elite level competition. Oftentimes your genetics are not enough. And also, if you look in a gym, if you've been lifting for about a year, year and a half, you can pretty much pick out the people who are on performance enhancing drugs. You can also pick out the people who have amazing genetics, and oftentimes you will understand that it's not an easy thing to determine who's doing which one of those things, who's got the amazing genetics and who's on steroids. And I'd honestly don't worry about that too much. If you want to do them, that's your own shtick. I'm not going to judge you for doing them. If you realize that there's a risk, okay, and there's a reward, and you choose the reward over the risk of damaging your health, it's your decision. I'm not in control of that. I don't recommend anybody do them because it's illegal. It can harm you. I don't do them, and it's for those two reasons. But that's besides the point. The fact of the matter is, most people who you look up to, most of the greats of the world, are using performance-enhancing drugs, and actually at the same time are at the elite level of genetics. So what is a realistic expectation for an absolute raw novice to gain in terms of strength and size through the use of the gym and, I guess, their own cardiovascular devices? So if you are an absolute novice, if you're, let's say that you're like me, right? When I started, I was 18. I was, that was when I really got into fitness. I didn't really start doing it religiously until I was 19, but when I was 18, going for a ride on a bike, as Mark Ripito says, made my chest grow. I had that little muscle that any sort of strenuous activity would add weight to my bench. That's how it works for the absolute raw novice, but you will notice that that will end after about 2 weeks of doing that, and you'll have to actually bench press in order to make your bench press go up. Now, assuming that your training is on point, you're hitting every muscle part twice or more per week, I recommend doing a full body routine 3 times a week. You're doing your cardio regularly, you're sleeping properly, your stress is down and your nutrition is on point, and also assuming that you're in either a caloric surplus or close to it and not in a deficit. Assuming those things, you will be able to gain about 10 to 15 pounds of muscle in 1 year. If you're a male, you'll probably be able to hit 225 bench, 315 squat, 405 deadlift. If you're a little bit under that, I wouldn't worry about it too much. I was underneath that in my first year. I got those gains as they came in my second year. If you're a woman, expect to gain a little less muscle because you do not have the male hormone at the same level that men do. You don't have testicles, so you do not produce it at the same rate as men. So at the same time, your strength isn't going to go up by that much, but you can expect to probably squat about 135, give or take again, depending on your size. You can expect to bench probably about 95 pounds, again, or more, or less, again, depending on who you are. And I find that women have a very easy time with deadlifts. So when you're doing deadlifts, after about a year, you can probably get anywhere from 225 to 275. Again, these are all in windows because everybody's genetics are different. You shouldn't expect somebody who starts this whole thing at 110 pounds to make the same progress as somebody who starts their journey at 250 pounds. But in your second year, you will notice that you will experience diminishing returns. That is to say, your muscle and strength gain after you have begun training, after 1 year, it goes up asymptotically. You will experience nowhere near the same level of gains that you did when you started this thing. Your body has a genetic limit to how much muscle it wants to put on itself without the use of anabolic steroids or any sort of exogenous hormones. And that is the wall that we often hit. I'm there right now. If, now I'm not going to say I am, but this would be the perfect time for me to start using gear, because in my fourth year, last year, I put 50 pounds on my deadlift. I put about, actually no, that's a lie, I put about 30 pounds on my deadlift. I put about, 15 pounds on my bench, and I got an injury that prevented me from squatting properly. So I didn't really gain any strength on the squat. In fact, I probably lost some. And that isn't to say, though, guys, that you can't make gains past this point. You can. I still am. You just have to find either things that you've neglected. You have to make sure that, again, your sleep is, and your sleep and limiting your stress. Those are two of the biggest things that you can do to help yourself make gains. You gotta make sure your nutrition is on point more now than ever. And you have to do certain advanced techniques to help you get through these plateaus that you will always be having problems with. So again, bulking is something that you're going to have to consider if you haven't done it yet. I will make another video on that, but that's something that you're going to have to consider. So those are the reasonable expectations that you can have. So you know, in your second year, you're not going to have as much strength and size gain as you did in your first. Third year, you're not going to have the same level of strength and size gain that you did in your second. And it tapers off eventually to the point where your fourth, fifth, sixth year, just a little bit less every year, but you will still be making gains. So what I'm saying, don't give up, because you have to keep going. You always have to keep going. Because if you stop and you stagnate, that's when you stop having satisfaction, that's when you lose your gains, that's when you stop going to the gym. So I hope this video has shed some light on that subject. I hope that you share this with your friends who are novices because they need this information. And I hope you like the video. It's just a freaking click. I'm waiting. Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate that. So, until next time, everybody, take care and have a nice day.